Hello, everyone. My name is Keith Marzullo. I'm the Dean of the College of Information Studies, and I want to welcome you to this inaugural Dean's Lecture Series talk. We've set this series up to bring leading scholars from across all the disciplines that are represented in the iSchool to hear interesting ideas and engage in stimulating discussion to help us all expand what we're thinking about. This is being recorded, so you should be aware of that. You can ask questions using the Q&A feature, and Dr. Bang has also agreed to monitor the chat. So if you have a burning question you need an answer right away, please feel free to enter it into the chat window. So let's get started. Our speaker today is Dr. Megan Bang. Dr. Bang is professor of learning sciences and psychology at Northwestern University and is currently serving as a senior vice president at the Spencer Foundation. Dr. Bang studies dynamics of culture, learning, and development with a focus on the complexities of navigating multiple meaning systems in creating and implementing more effective and just learning environments. Dr. Bang focuses on dimensions of reasoning and decision-making about complex socio-ecological systems, such as the role of perspective-taking, temporal and spatial scales, and relational construals and their intersection with culture, identity, power, and historicity. She conducts research in schools, informal learning environments, and everyday community contexts with people and places across the life course, and often utilize robust participatory methods with communities. Dr. Bang is a member of the National Academy of Education. She also currently serves on the Board of Science Education and the National Academy of Sciences and the National Science Foundation's Education Human Resources Advisory Committee, as well as NSF Advisory Committee on Environmental Research and Education. I think we're very fortunate to have Dr. Bang come talk with us. Please welcome me and welcoming Dr. Megan.
Thanks so much for having me all. I'm looking forward to sharing this work with you today. I also want to just acknowledge the work that I'm going to share today has been done in deep collaboration with my colleague, Carrie Zoe, and so we sometimes take turns talking about this work. So I want to start today, hopefully everyone can see this, is just by recognizing Indigenous peoples, lands, and waters. And I partly do this because both for my work, and I think as you'll see, it's deeply relevant to the work and the things that I do. And I start with this particular image because it usually is not the way that the world organizes information or understands Indigenous peoples. And so the image in front of you is these purple lands are the territories that are currently governed by Indigenous peoples. And I like to say a quarter of all land is in Indigenous hands. But as you'll notice today, my work is particularly concerned around relations and focus on human relations and learning environments with the natural world. So I'm coming to you from my original ancestral territories of the Three Fires people, what most of you probably have coded as Chicago, and hope that wherever you all are, that you take some time to know whose lands and territories you're on. Okay, so here's what I'm gonna do today. I'm gonna share some pretty big ideas and framings that kind of give an umbrella to the overall work that I'm up to, partly as an invitation into those big ideas. And then I'm gonna dive into a particular project. And this is a little bit different than what I told you I was gonna do because I thought I was gonna be slick and tell you about two projects and decided that was a bad idea. So I'm really just gonna focus on one project. And really dig into how we're thinking about this. And this project is a it's a co-design project focused on PK3. And I guess for you all, part of what I want to really emphasize today is that I engage in the design of learning environments as a way to think about setting up the conditions for learning and relations, and really how is it that we shape those learning environments to create new configurations of knowledge organization, reasoning, and decision-making in the world. So that's sort of the plan. Hoping to do that in a couple of variety of ways, and we'll see where we get. So I'm looking forward to questions and being able to talk with you a little bit about it. So in my scholarship, broadly across my scholarship, I am really focused on what I see as a central possibility. Sometimes I use the word challenge instead of possibility of the 21st century. And that is living and transforming the Anthropocene through cultivating just, culturally thriving, and sustainable communities. And for me, there's a broad question about how can and should, I put science education in brackets, but I mean education broadly, contribute to what I would call broad-scale socio-ecological change. And I come at this perspective with a kind of view of power and history that often education, and particularly in the United States, education has had a bit of an assimilative ideological demand on many, many cultural communities. And so I'm really after how is it that we could contribute to broad scale family communities and Earth's thriving through a much more expansive view of what education could be. This is located a little bit, and I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with the Next Generation Science Standards and the sort of large scale paradigm shift that has been underway, at least in the science ed world, around understanding that science education and science learning is a cultural phenomena. That there is nothing in the world that is acultural. And this is a kind of quote from that framework that says, children and adults the world over explore their surroundings and converse about the seeming causes and consequences of the phenomena they observe, but they're raised in environments with varied exposures to activities that relate to different science and engineering domains. What counts as learning and what types of knowledge are seen as important are closely tied to a community's values and what is useful for that community context. One of the things that I like to emphasize about that is that we kind of take this as given now, that knowing is always cultural. There isn't a neutral base, and there's always perspective in it. And for us in this work, part of what we've been pushing on is getting people to recognize that all teaching and learning, therefore, is political and ethical, and that the design of learning environments is a series of decisions about what and whose politics and ethics. And this is really pulled from a series of work, but I just wanted to emphasize that when we design learning environments, we're making decisions about what ways of knowing or in what kinds of the sort of academic ease around what ontologies, epistemologies, axiologies are resourced and made present for learners, and what social futures. Manuel Espinosa talks about how are we creating the grounds for social dreaming and whose social futures. And so we think about that a lot. And I have been thinking about that as a way to think about the design of learning environments for some time, but you'll see more of that. At core, across the work that I engage in is thinking about the foundational ontological relations between human worlds or cultural worlds, and the natural world, and more than human world. And this comes from some work with teachers, but there's a whole long history of research in different disciplines and domains thinking about this fundamental relationship. Part of what I've been up to for a long time is kind of thinking about how this works with people's knowledge organization and its impacts on reasoning, its impacts on attentional habits, and its impacts on decision-making. And in our work over time and many different projects, there tend to be these kind of two different paradigms. One in which we say human beings are thought about as a part of the natural world, that is, we're embedded, or apart from. And oftentimes we think about that as kind of human, what I've referred to as human supremacy or human exceptionalism, where human beings are distinct from the rest of the natural world. And certainly we have a global infrastructure that tends to privilege that paradigm. Part of what you should hear is, I am interested in how these core cognitive models that are cultural and have been shaped over history actually form the grounds for learning environments and what we've taken as given. And part of what we've been after in our world, in our work, is that apart from models, that is human beings separated from the natural world, have been dominant in our educational systems. It's very simple to think about it this way. We take children from their families and communities and put them inside school buildings for the majority of the day. And the majority of that day doesn't engage outside those buildings as context for learning. What is engaged there is play. And so we've really de-intellectualized actually the outside world from these buildings. And part of what you should really hear is that what we are after is understanding how these, what we can see is an iSpy, an ecosystem that may seem fairly innocent, actually is completely connected to the kind of sociopolitical context and larger issues that we see on the right playing out across the globe. And for us, we're really interested in how is there, are we setting up or reifying the conditions within our educational systems that are contributing to our broad scale socio-ecological challenges. And for me in this work, I think a lot about how apart from models, teach a kind of human entitlement and extraction paradigm that is unsustainable and one of the core challenges of the 21st century. So you might ask, okay, that's a little overwhelming and a lot, so what should we do? And really what we've been up to is thinking about how is it we create learning environments where the intersections of science and civics and justice actually are the formations and the beginnings. And part of why I think we haven't gotten there is there's a long line of research that claimed that novices couldn't reason about socio-ecological systems very well. But over the last 20 years or so, there's some important ruptures in that and some emerging evidence that some cultural communities actually do it quite easily, others do not, and that under the right conditions with the right supports, it seems like things like attending to spatial and temporal multiplicities, being able to reason across different scales is possible. So then the question becomes, how is it we continue to scale the opportunity for those? I'll say one of the reasons that I think it's important for us to hold this, and for me, this is as we think about context of education, our educational systems tend to be regressive, meaning that we teach stuff that is pretty settled and not the edges of our science or the edges of our discipline. And so part of what I want everyone to hold is that we spend a lot of time thinking about the edges of multiple disciplines. And there is a lot of shifting landscape around things like legal scholarship, economic paradigms, scientific paradigms that are really trying to push beyond a kind of human supremacy or apart from models towards what a lot of folks are kind of thinking about is ethical complex socio-ecological systems. People don't necessarily use that word. Sometimes it's coupled human nature systems, and for ecologists or engineers have different views. So we don't know that, I think there's good consensus about the language here, but I wanna say that the false separation of kind of human and natural worlds is a core issue across many disciplines. And indeed, this is from a lovely paper that came out in Nature this past year, that there is increasing evidence that our social systems are deeply consequential for understanding scientific outcomes. And this particular paper is doing really interesting work looking at the evolution of coyotes in particular, and its correlation with residential segregation by race, as well as income, and that those things are actually correlated and may be causing evolutionary shifts in coyotes. So I just wanted to put this bigger space that many people are beginning to look at, that at this point in science education, I would argue is not central to our models. So what I'm going to show you today is a project. It's a design research project that that we are after trying to develop new models. And the way that we've approached that is hopefully resonant with some of you and the ways that you might think about your work. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit about this project and dive into the details. So this is a big team. We're in a partnership with both community organizations as well as a school district, and have a lot of folks contributing, but just wanna acknowledge that this work is done in a team and lots going on there. This project has been a 4-year participatory design research project. We have community leaders and educators and school district leaders, community-based organizations, and families and their children as co-designers. And we've been after really pushing on what we call designing with rather than about places. Place-based design is a kind of, or place-based education is somewhat common in school systems, but there's a difference about learning about places as distinct from learning with them. And so we've been really trying to move from away from kind of about and really shifting kids to be learning outdoors and thinking about what happens to human learning and sense making when we're not in that apart from core relationship. And I guess the thing that I'll say is we were also deeply after kind of remaking and reimagining relationships between people, institutions, and places. So while we're after field-based science and thinking about place and its role in learning environments, we're also holding that schools' relationships and the relational infrastructure with kids and families comes from particular histories, particular power relations that we were simultaneously trying to shift. So what I'm going to do today is tell you a little bit about what we designed. And the ways that we think about this is that we designed, we call this our Learning in Places ecosystem. And we were really thinking about how is it that we infrastructure and create the conditions for different kinds of learning and reasoning. And we have four ways of thinking about that. We have our Project Rhizome, and I'll tell you more about each of these. Which is really our learning, our principles of learning that guide everything and kind of propagate throughout our materials ecosystem. We have our frameworks that are really for educators to support them in kind of understanding key conceptual areas within what we're trying to design. We have something we call storylines, and I don't know how many people are familiar with kind of the storyline paradigm, but it's really a movement in science education to move from kind of activities, singular activities, to understanding that rigorous learning takes time, and there are different stages, and people have been kind of organizing them around what people call storylines. So we have a classroom storyline, but we were very deliberate about also developing what we call a family storyline, and I'll tell you more details about this. But central to our storylines, and quite different than lots of other places, or a lot of other storylines, is that we were driven by should we questions. And these should we questions, we were really interested in motivating what are questions that drive kind of ethical inquiry and investigations that both demand children wanting to understand how things work in the world, and then being able to engage in why and how questions alongside change making and decision making. And I'll say more about that. And then the last thing is our learning engagement. So within the storyline, there are bundles of lesson plans that kind of take educators and kiddos and their families through the storyline at a smaller grain size that we call learning engagements. Okay. So here's our key principles. This is our rhizome. And part of what I want to highlight, I keep saying we, as if Carrie's on the phone with, or on the call with me, is there are really five core dimensions. And what you'll notice here is our backdrop for how we design everything has this core nature-culture relations, where we are trying to design a model that that learning is a part of, that human beings are a part of the natural world, and doing so with a deep view of how power and historicity, that is, what are the powered and historical relations that have given rise to the current and continue to show up in interaction and teaching and learning. And that really is the foundation. And then there are these three other dimensions that we're always working on. So first is, how are we thinking about complex socio-ecological systems? What can and should kiddos be doing? How is it that we're always engaging with kids, cultural repertoires, their families and communities? And then what is asked of educators who are engaged in field-based science learning that might be distinct from how they've been engaged in indoor science learning? Just to give a high level view of like, what are these educator tools? What is probably important and might be of interest to you all is that we ended up developing a kind of what we call visual conceptual vocabulary that became super important for our teachers. None of this existed before. Our teachers really wanted representations of the big ideas that we were learning about and thinking about together that became kind of posters in their room and helped them hold the complexity of them. And so we have a lot of these, but just to say this is kind of a representation of our power and historicity framework. And these were used for lots of different ways as a way to understand and see these conceptual issues in kids' learning, how it is that you engage in the design of learning environments with it, how you think about this dimension in relationship to collaborative practice, whether it's with community-based organizations or families. But also we had a set of kinds of self-evaluation and reflection tools for educators, for them to be able to think about their own knowledge organization and assumptions over time. So this is an overview of our seasonal classroom storyline. I'm going to walk you through this because don't be overwhelmed by this representation. But I wanted you all to see the overview of this. This was the way that is kind of, you can think about, this is the roadmap that we developed with teachers and families around what a storyline would look like and what would the different components were. And there's really 9 dimensions, and I'm going to go through them fast, but I want to make sure you can kind of read this storyline, that are unusual for most design practices. And so I'm going to go through I'm going to go through them pretty quickly, but so then you can see where they are in this. And it won't move forward. Okay. So one thing you should know is that we took seriously the next generation science practices that most schools and, well, states that have adopted NGSS are required for. And so these are just elevating that these give deep structure to the entire storyline. You don't need to know the details about that, but I just want you to see that. But one of the important things is we were really deliberate about creating what we call porous classrooms, and that there were 3 dimensions of this. What we call in the field, when children and educators were actually outdoors, not inside their school buildings, or in the field. In classrooms, right? What was actually happening in their classroom structures. And then with families and communities. And part of what I want to elevate here is that this is partly unusual in that we pulled connecting with families and communities as both foundational to the storyline and showing up across all the activities, which is not actually how most of our educators engage in practice. I also wanna kind of think about how this moves across. And what we started with in the storyline was really grounding people in what we call histories of places and a broader concept of phenology. And phenology is the study of how seasons work. And one of the biggest issues around climate change for the lived experience of climate change is how everyone's seasons are actually shifting, and our social systems are set up not to be particularly responsive to those seasonal shifts. So we start there. But one of the other things is that our questions, our should we questions, have really been developed through what we call place emergent wonderings. This is partly that helping kiddos ask meaningful questions that are grounded in places requires facilitation. And this is connected actually to that, our point about it's with places, not about places. Many place-based curriculum give kids a place to investigate core concepts in, and we really wanted these to be place emergent. And for there to be should we questions that actually drove these investigations, deliberations, and broader decision-making towards ending in a storyline that is really leading towards broader change making and socio-ecological decision making. So there's lots to say about this. I'm happy to say more, but I wanted at least for you all to see the structure of that. I'm not gonna share all the details about this today, but I'm gonna share aspects of what we've learned through our pilot studies of this design being implemented in classrooms. So there are really 3 kinds of findings that I'm going to try to get through today, and I think we'll probably be fine. So the first one is that what we've learned is there's really important variation in spatial and temporal scales in children's and families' thinking, and that largely these, so first we would say that lots of people don't design or even see those, and that they're actually really critical for us to support learning about complex socio-ecological systems and to do it in ways that don't reify normative power. So I'm going to show you a little bit of evidence for this. So one of our frameworks, and this is where we start in our storyline, is what we call with the socio-ecological histories of places. And so on the right is this framework, and it's kind of core to being able to think about systems, that you have to think across, within and across different timescales, and understanding how the kinds of socio-ecological phenomena that is really important for 21st century issues isn't located in any one temporality. One thing that you should note about this is we are, the locations of these temporalities are both in more than human timescales, as well as different political states. So notice that there's Indigenous people's time as well as nation state time and global time. And I'm going to talk more about that in a second. But I also want to point out that this this column to the right, the living ethical responsibilities and possibilities, that is engaging in learning environments that are always attuning children to possible futures, we infrastructured as part of thinking. So what I'm going to show you is we conducted interviews with about 380 children and did pre-post interviews around understanding their temporalities. And I'm just going to show you a little bit about what we learned around what kiddos think about in terms of these 6 different scales. And here's what I'll tell you. So we get lots of nation state and plant animal time in kiddos thinking. Partly what is really challenging for us is to recognize that children seem to have no ideas about Indigenous people's time or attend to future possibilities time. What you might notice is that we had a pre-post pilot, at least for the older kids in this study, we got significant shifts in their attention to seasonal time, but very little shifts in the other temporal scales. And so for us, this has been a really important shift in our design work and attending to this. And it tells us something about what is made present or not made present for children and learning opportunities. As part of this, we also spent a lot of time, I mentioned that we pulled family and community through the whole storyline. The way that we did this is that we designed what we called family tools. And those family tools, some people might call that homework, but they were coordinated across the storyline. And they were really intended to make family and community experiences and expertise visible and present for educators and kiddos across the time. And these tools actually were intended to remediate the relationships between families and educational institutions so that families and communities were assumed to have expertise and positioned as partners in learning. And the other thing that it was intended to do was really help with the idea that the phenomena in school is all around kiddos. It's not just something you learn in school. It's relevant to your everyday life and is present in and around your community as a way of actually helping to embed a part of models and not sort of thinking about scientific knowledge or science learning as apart from family and community life. So what did we learn? I'm pulling from Charlene Nolan, who was a graduate student at this time. And the study that I'm about to show you, some of the findings come from her brilliant dissertation work, where she examined all of the family tools that came in from our first year of pilot. And she developed an entire family engagement framework, which is this graphic on the right that came from this. So what did we learn here? So when we did an analysis of the family tools, one of the things that was most interesting to us is if you look at the graph on the left with all of the different greens, is that a lot of families, indeed somewhere close to 40% of families were attending to global lands and waters or global nation state places in their family tools. When we first made this histories of places, we did not have global time in our design framework. And what's interesting is this showed up despite the fact that we hadn't designed tools that asked for it. And why did it show up? Is because in the school systems that we were in, there were lots of recently immigrated students and families. And our design hadn't recognized that they brought really relevant expertise to learning environments. And so we redesigned actually to make sure that the global time was present. And what's also interesting about this is one of those moments when you're like, weren't you interested in things like climate change and trying to shift that? You can't understand climate change without attention to global time. And so part of why I like to show these findings is to just recognize that how we design is always political and ethical. And in this earlier design, I would argue that this is a kind of infrastructure that invisibilizes the deep expertise that recently immigrated families bring with them and kiddos to learning environments and make it more challenging for them. So this was an important both early analysis and shift in our design work. The second finding that I want to highlight is how much the actual place of learning seems to be mattering. And part of what I'll just say is we are really after understanding, does learning in places instead of just about places matter? In an analysis of family tools, and we sort of broke up our family tools and the classroom tools, but this is only analysis of the family tools. On the left in this representation are what we call family discussion tools. That is, they were tools where we asked kids to have a conversation with their families at home. And that's that large red bar and a little bit of purple. On the right is what we call family walk. These were tools where we asked families to go outside, take walks around their block, take walks around their apartment buildings, and engage in a set of observations. And what we did is we analyzed what was their attention, what kinds of concepts, what kinds of content did they focus on. And what I want you all to notice is that the red family of codes are human-centered, or what we might call anthropocentric. The purples and blues and mauves are actually all the content that is focused on more than humans. And so what's really important about this is that literally same families engaged in thinking and learning in outdoor places shifts their attentional focus beyond kind of human-centric or what we would call apart from models. And so towards humans being a part of. And it's just important to recognize it's a dramatic shift of attention and kinds of sense making. While I'm not gonna show you the data today, it turns out we're nearly replicating this when we compare what is the talk when you're inside a classroom with a group of kids versus outside on your playground, walking around your community, or in things like local parks and such. So the point here is the context, the places of learning actually deeply shift and influence attentional habits. The last one I wanna focus a little bit on what we're calling why interpretive power and sort of infrastructuring all these frameworks has become really important. And a lot of what we've been after is helping educators learn to see how power and historicity is shaping interactional moments. And I'm just gonna say this quickly, this is building off the work of Anne Roseberry and Beth Warren and colleagues who really looked at how educators tend to have two different kinds of stances. One, a behavioral stance towards kiddos or in a sense-making stance. And in a behavioral stance, there tends to be a default that there's a lot of control and compliance kinds of interactions, that in a behavioral stance, there's often more talk focused on privileging normative or settled ways of knowing, talking, seeing, and interacting. And that often this behavioral stance is really shaped by European American practices, values, and relationships, and often re-entrenches deficit views because it often doesn't actually see what kinds of sense-making children are trying to engage in. And so in their work, they're really thinking about sense-making stances, about what is it the kiddo is trying to make sense of? How are we seeing what they're doing? And that there tends to be greater attunement and assumptions that kiddos are trying to engage in intellectual generative activity, that student talk may not be complete, but there is always a kind of ongoing co-construction of meaning. And in our work, part of what we're pushing towards is this purple box where there's a next step after sense-making, that once you've cultivated a kind of sense-making stance, then you can start to engage in what we call ethical design and decision-making from a pedagogical place, that you can start to see and recognize when power is being replicated in interactional moments, and you can engage more in intentional, skilled intervention in that. And I'm going to show you an example of what we mean by that. I also will tell you that we are sharing this work because as much as we think everyone should be engaging in field-based science education, one thing that we've learned is without some deliberate attention to this, taking kiddos outdoors can actually elevate harm for some children over others. So I'm going to do this through a vignette we call Nick and the Charger. I'm recognizing time, so I think we'll get through this. But this is a vignette that came from this work, one of our implementations. And it's a second grade class. They were going for a wandering watch, which was at the beginning of our storyline. And I'm gonna show you a video. I'm gonna show you a clip and I'm gonna stop it halfway through. We're gonna talk a little bit and then I'm gonna show you the second half of the clip. And I want you to think about how do you see Nick engaging in sense-making and how others are engaging with him. And I want you to think about, are there forms of power or social dynamics that you're seeing in this clip already? So I have to shift so I can show you my video screen. Here it is. All right.
Baby tree. Look, a baby. Sasha, baby tree.
It's a pine tree.
No,
I think it's an evergreen, actually. Where did you find that cell?
So, you know what makes me think there was something here that I'm thinking of? So, what do you think?
I think it was over a year ago. No, I'm sure it's recent. Recent, and maybe some of it was over a year ago.
I even see. What? Charger! Look at this! There's even a charger here!
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Who would.
Well, it's coming along. Let's see if you want to get. And there's none here. So, my
God. Yeah, there's nothing way up there.
And look, there's even a charger!
Everywhere. Samuel, please stop kicking that. You're picking up dirt and making desk go everywhere. She just asked you to.
Okay. So I'm going to pause this for a second, and then we'll come back to this. Navigating. All right. So I'd love for people to just take a second. I don't know how much time we actually have for chat, but I want you to think about what has just happened. And here's a little bit of the dialogue, but essentially Nick in their wandering walk has discovered a charger, and here's what he says, and you just heard this, and we hear Carly say, Nick, please stop kicking that, you're kicking that there and making dust go everywhere. And I just want you all to think about whether, if you were Miss Dahlia or Miss Rivers, what would you do next in this very moment? And I'm not going to give you much time. If people will think about what's that next move, it'd be great. I'm not sure I can find the chat right now. But if you were this teacher, what would you do at this moment? Okay, well, I can't seem to see anyone chatting, so I'm going to show you the rest of this clip and kind of take you through it. So here is what happens. Hopefully you all can see.
She just asked you to stop doing something. Did you stop? Listen, did you stop? Why?
Because it looks so weird.
Okay, but she said the dirt was going in their eyes. Is that okay?
She never said they were going.
She started just picking up dirt. So come here, friend. Turn off your camera a second.
I can't.
I need to talk. Turn it off for a second.
I can't.
Part of what you all, we had a second stream, so we actually see what's happening here between Nick and his teacher. What we see is a lot of behavioral modification happening right now. What I'm gonna do is actually stop that and move us through back to a data slide about this. And I wanna draw your attention to a couple of things that is happening here. So what we see is Miss Rivers says, Carly asked you to stop, did you stop? And she asked why, and he says, because it looks so weird. And Miss River actually escalates what she says is Nick causing harm to Carly, right? The dirt was going in your eyes. And Nick actually immediately is like, she never said that. And she goes on to turn off the camera so she can continue to actually tell him about his behavior. And part of what we want to pull out here is that if you noticed in the beginning, Nick was an incredibly animated and excited kiddo. He was pointing out observations left and right. And what we see is a slow grade non-attention to him. If you see, the two teachers were actually not focused on any of his interests while he was vying for attention, and he was kind of asserting intellectual interest throughout. What happens is when Nick gets attention is through a behavioral stance, right? The teacher responds to him and asserts that he needs to engage in a kind of physical compliance. What we are arguing and thinking about, how this is what it looks like for a Black boy in second grade to kind of have his body policed. We even see a literal turning off of camera. I will tell you that this happened pre-pandemic. So the elevation of this now is telling. And that what we really see is a reification of a white woman policing a Black boy's body and not attending to his intellectual interests at all here. The other thing that we want to point to is that Carly is also learning something. Carly is also learning that she has the power to leverage adult authority to force compliance on her peer here. And so there are multiple dimensions here. And part of the reason that for us in this work that it becomes incredibly important is to recognize that we all participate as being Miss Rivers at different times, and that we swim in systemic racism. It shapes our interactional moments and our ways of seeing things. And that part of the responsibility is to be able to get better and skilled at recognizing its reproductions, even if unintended. And for us, part of the reason this becomes a really important story about why and what it looks like to engage in field-based science ed is that we noticed that when we first started taking kiddos outside, the escalation of boys of color's bodies happening in new practice was very, very visible. And so in our second times around, we had to spend much more time helping people to recognize their potentially less obvious ways of policing bodies in their classrooms, although it was always there too, or else these new models of science education actually perpetuated some harms. So why I want to mirror here for a second with the early slide where I said I spy an ecosystem is connected to the kind of broad scale socio-political dynamics that happen around people's nature culture relations. Our point here is that while these interactions in a second grade classroom may not be at the same scale as kind of this example of birding while Black, the point about this is that these early grade and these early configurations of activity set the conditions for these ongoing sociopolitical issues at broad scale societal level. And the policing of Black bodies in particular is a deeply historicized, racialized practice, both in outdoor spaces and by white women in particular. And all of the teachers that have been involved in this have spent a lot of time thinking about what is the narrative and sharing that we should be doing about this. So I really want to emphasize that we don't think about this as a singular teacher who was problematic. We actually saw this across all of our educators and recognized that they needed practice at recognizing how this happened quite quickly. So to end, I kind of want to just end with a couple of high level things and then hopefully have some time for questions and conversation. But it's important to recognize that power and historicity are ubiquitous, and there isn't a way to set up learning environments or the configuration of knowledge systems or the access of information somewhere outside of that ongoing power and historicity. And in our work, we kind of think that we have to be relentless in our attention to creating the possible and in transforming the normative around power and historicity. And just to say, we have all kinds of additional analysis. This is a huge project that is still underway. I won't say much about that, except for it might be interesting for some of you to recognize that we've built this into our new pre-service teacher education classes and are really trying to think about what happens when you start teaching science education with models like this, when you engage educators at the very beginning about thinking about power and historicity or understanding race and racialization, and doing it in a way that says this isn't about any one individual's identity or racial identities, but it's actually a societal condition that we all have roles in. And as a way to help teachers recognizing their own cultural practices and ways to draw on those things. So we are about a couple hundred teachers in now to using this to really ground them in teacher ed and getting some really interesting findings there. And then I guess I'll also just, we have designed a series of tools. We're about to release a garden-based storyline that is specifically for gardens, as well as a series of professional learning for informal science educators. And I just say that because I wanted to share that the design of ecosystems in this kind of way has become a kind of modeling and an approach that is really growing in a whole number of ways that people are taking up and running with. So I'm going to end by just saying what I hope to remind you is that this was an example of a design project that is trying to take up some bigger ideas and reimagine models of education that really transforms how we organize our knowledge, how we reason about things, and how we take up and how we engage in decision making. And hopefully you've been able to follow that thread through, and I've shown you some detailed ways that we're up to doing that. And I'll end with just a thank you. I'm happy to have and continue conversation and hear some information about where you can learn more about our work. And I'll stop.
Thank you so much. What questions do people have? Again, you can put them in the chat or the Q&A. I can also give permission to people to ask questions live. So if you would prefer to speak and ask your question, you should be able to raise your hand or put something in the chat and I can then give you that. Oh, Tammy, I'm going to allow you to talk.
Hi, thank you, Megan, for your talk. That example was very powerful. And I guess the question that it raises for me is being someone who is like not as much of an outdoor person, but trying to become more of an outdoor person, I could imagine how like you may have to work with teachers so that they don't get into this mode of fear that then drives them into that sort of like escalating those like behavioral issues versus like picking up on the inquiry that that our boys like Nick or Nicholas are doing. So I just was wondering like what are some of the ways I guess that you address that in your teacher education programs? Like how do you help teachers to navigate and address those types of issues?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, I mean, first of all, we actually ask people to start by going for walks around their neighborhoods. And a lot of what we end up seeing is that people think the natural world is in like some distant park away from urban centers. Like that's the default assumption that the natural world is elsewhere. And so the first thing that we do is we actually have people engage in just going for walks around their neighborhoods to start re-seeing the natural world around them. And then the other thing that we do is what we call place designing. So we end up facilitating teachers walking around and going within walking areas from their schools to think about what the place affords for learning. But your deeper question is connected to that longer history of nature-culture relations. We have been slowly creating the sensibility that the natural world is harmful, is dirty, is someplace where we should be avoided, right? That's been a longer history. We can see it in things like was one of the great American novel themes was man versus nature for a long time. And so that core worry about whether or not the outdoor world is a good place for learning is a really important thing at a general level. The other thing that we do is we spend a lot of time helping people to understand how the outdoor world is raced and gendered in really particular ways. Parks in Chicago, for example, are not safe for women to go to some parks at night, right? And that there are some parks and some outdoor places where there are more police cars than there are in other parks and places. And I can tell you in some of our work, I've had groups of kids in forest preserves and we've had five crews of cops with their dogs show up, assuming that we're a group of brown people, we must be doing something bad in the middle of the park. So the reads of who is outdoors and whether it's safe to do it is really complicated. And for us, there's been kind of slow routine practices that don't actually make people jump deeply into always teaching outdoors immediately. The other one that I'll tell you that we have spent a lot of time on and had to do a lot of like really challenging teachers, particularly in Seattle, is the folks who are experiencing homelessness, that population of people is pretty dense in Seattle. So many There are many parks around school districts where there are also homeless encampments. And teachers projected that homeless folks were violent and scary, and so therefore it wasn't safe for them to take their kids anywhere near the parks. And that is actually a really inaccurate understanding. Folks who are experiencing homelessness are less likely to commit crimes than folks who have homes. And in fact, they're actually more the victims of crimes than they are the perpetrators of crimes. But the default was a perception that really had a different dynamic. So part of what my long answer to you is, we have a set of practices and then we have a set of conceptual issues that really challenge people to recognize how they're viewing the outdoors and question that.
Thank you. Thank you. That's great.
I see a question. The integration of computing or computational thinking, how do you reconcile those, or how do you think we could balance the push to prepare students for a computational world and the perspective I've shared? Actually, we're developing a mobile tool to do half of our observations. And I actually think that there's super interesting possibilities. The other thing that we're doing is kind of annotated virtual world, mobile virtual worlds can actually deepen experiences in field-based settings in all kinds of ways. So I think that I'm actually super excited about that intersection and don't see them, I don't see them as necessarily in contradiction with each other. I do think that if our adult assumption that computing happens sitting down with a kind of sedimentary bias that happens sitting down at a table, then it could be. But I have to tell you, I have a deep worry about our assumption that computing education works best through a sedimentary form of engagement. Not that you couldn't do both. I don't advocate that we shouldn't do lab-based sciences too, but it's really what's the ecosystem of different forms of engagement that actually are co-generated. And so that's kind of how I think about that. But I think it's a good, hard question. The only other thing that I'll elevate, computational thinking is one of the things in our work that we're working on. It's harder to, we haven't quite gotten there with kindergartners, but some of the other work that I do with older kids, we actually engage in a lot of modeling, and computational thought and its relationship to kind of dynamic systems modeling is a huge possibility. And so the other thing I'll just say is that as we deepen in our model development and different aspects of our storyline, we're actually really interested in continuing to deepen how kids are engaged with things like modeling, things like understanding what it means to be able to think about dynamic systems at different scales. And then I think there's lots of ways to integrate really deep computing kinds of goals within this storyline. I see another question about, were the students able to reflect on the roles that teacher students could slip into and how these roles might relate to their education and future lives? So that's a really good question. So we're in the middle of that kind of work, particularly with teacher educators, but I'll go back to that first finding about temporal scales. One of the bigger pieces of work that we've been able to do around this, and it's leading to work around the micro interactional ways of doing what you're talking about, is kiddos and teachers recognize the absence of Indigenous people. And we had spent a lot of time talking about how systemic racism for Indigenous people takes typically, well, there's lots of forms, but a prominent form is our absence, right? That people think that Indigenous peoples are not present or only of the past is actually the systemic racism. Of course, you can get to the stereotyped images, but we spend a lot of time talking about how our absence is actually the way to perpetuate harm against Indigenous people. And teachers did develop a lot of, and kiddos trying to think about that, but also being able to think about their own stereotypes about Indigenous folks is one of the things that we've done more on. The pieces that are really specific around boys of color, and Black boys in particular, is that we've done a lot of actually working on being able to see kiddos' reasoning and thinking about how teachers come to recognize the vies for intellectual focus much earlier than they were. And kind of holding themselves accountable to responses. And we've really been working on saying, lots of teachers will have a behavioral instinct. And we've been working on, and this is really, folks at Shoshe Konan are working on this for a long time, is to getting teachers to admit that, and then to remediate their own instincts to say, okay, rather than deciding what is happening here is a behavioral issue, what does it mean to see it as an intellectual role? And so that's a lot of where we're at. What we have not done as much at, I really love the question around kind of informer or witness and perpetrator, is we've spent more time actually helping kiddos think about and engage with each other's ideas. One of the things that we see a lot of is the assumption that young children can't engage with each other's ideas. So we've really infrastructured, what does it mean to take up each other's ideas, to deliberate with each other, to disagree with each other? And I'll say that I think we've accomplished a lot there, but it requires educators to model. What we don't always see is lots of spontaneous kids doing it when educators are actually modeling a different kind of behavior. So for us, we've really worked on helping educators see how to do it, because it's really helped them be able to do it with classrooms. I'd love to hear more about your work with teachers to help them see these prejudice views that they may have and encourage them to reflect or change those views. I'll tell you, one of the things that's been really important, and we have a whole sequence of data around the Wondering Walk with Nick. And part of what we do with teachers is actually take them through a series of video clips and help it slow down to see how something that happens in a short period of time and its accumulation is where these things live. And I think that part of what we see is a lot of educators think it's only the big events. But for us, it's really been about helping them to slow down and recognize what conditions are making those bigger events possible. And what does it mean to shift the conditions? I often tell people I think about myself either as a soil scientist or a water scientist, but that if you can create different conditions, you can grow different kinds of learning environments. And what it has taken is actually for educators to have to recognize that this is not, I think a lot of educators need language and understanding about what the difference is between kind of individualized racism and understanding systemic issues. And then understanding that these things play out at all different kinds of scales. And we've really taken the time to do that. Without that, I think it's very difficult for educators to shift. And what we've learned from our educators is that it helps them re-see kids. So once they can kind of get that view of things, their capacity to see kiddos' thinking is totally transformed. And I'll give you an example. One of our teachers said, you know, we've been talking about this as race, but I realize I've been doing this with English language learners terribly. And she said at one point, like, people do science all over the world. Not all scientists speak English, but I've been treating children who don't speak English fluently like they can't do science until they learn English. And so I think that what happens is that, we start to see a kind of paradigm shift that has its own growth curve when you get some key concepts in motion.
Thank you so much. I do believe we are at time, so I wanted to thank you again for your wonderful presentation today. So, and thank you to all those who attended. Is, as Keith mentioned, the first in the inaugural, it was the inaugural for the Dean's lecture series, and our next one is coming up in on May 5th. So look out for more information about that. But with that, again, I say thank you, and I hope you all have a good rest of your day.
Great, thank you so much. Take care.